Hi to everybody. And today topic is the source of Muslim law. It is first year, second semester course, Muslim law. The sources of Muslim law in India can be classified into two categories. One, primary sources, two, secondary sources. Primary sources are based on religious beliefs mentioned in the holy scriptures or books. And here the state or the central legislatures or the parliament and judicial decisions are the secondary sources. Primary sources are Holy Quran, Sunnah, Hadith, Ijma and Qiyas. Secondary sources, legislations either by the state or the central, as well as judicial pronouncements or decisions. Let us see the introduction regarding this chapter is concerned. In the introduction, let me say, Islam is one of the oldest and most followed pragmatic religion in the world. The religion entered into India with the Delhi Sultanate, that is the Mughals, and remained intact till now. Today, India is a secular country, with more than 15% of the populations being Muslims who would be administered justice among themselves according to their personal laws. This chapter aims to understand the source of Muslim personal law in India. That means, what are the sources available for the Muslims regarding their disputes within themselves in India. Source means the origin, a place from which a person or a thing has emerged. Muslim law has emerged from several traditional sources, and these sources are the governing pillars of the religion, because even today, in the 21st century, most of the Muslim personal laws are uncodified, and some which are codified are not being followed because of conflict with their traditional sources or customs. But still, there will be harmonized and most legislations will be followed among the Muslims. Now, legally speaking, there can be only parliament in central and the state legislatures, who is the law-making body of our nation. Nevertheless, since the personal law based on customs and practices of the religion, it is not possible to do justice with them and frame laws completely adverse to the religious beliefs. Hence, even the legislations base themselves on certain aspects of traditional sources. The sources of Muslim law can be divided into two categories, that as I said earlier, primary sources and secondary sources. And let us see what are the primary sources of Muslim law. Primary sources are these sources which are based on religious beliefs mentioned in holy scripture, Quran, or books. Those sources are universally accepted as the authentic, and they are the primary be relayed before any other sources. Any disputes relating to their personal law or family, the Muslim shall resort to these primary sources of law to understand the legal opinion in such situations or context. The known five primary sources of Muslim law are, number one, Holy Quran. Every religion emanates from one person who is believed to be the child or messenger or incarnation of God sent from above to imbibe the virtues in the people. These founders of religion usually store all their teachings and preachings to be followed and adhered to it in future in certain holy books written by themselves or through another. The Holy Quran is the holy book of Islam, which is believed to contain the direct words of God as perceived by the Prophet Muhammad. The Quran is like a grandnam. Grandnam means a German word. It is a German word meaning fundamental norm. And the Quran is like a grandnam for the Muslims, and it contains all principles used in personal laws, including marriage, divorce, succession, etc. In case of any question with respect to the personal laws of Islam, the Quran is the first source which needs to be looked into or referred. The book is divided into chapters, and each chapter contains several verses. And for instance, the book contains the chapter titled Marriage, and it contains the verses on how to get married, the procedure of marriage, nikah, divorce, etc. It is believed that Prophet Muhammad received the commandments of the God from the God himself in two places, Mecca and Medina. Of course, Jibreel alayhi salam is the person who is to bring the such a voice from the God to and he recited to the Prophet Muhammad. The commandment revealed at Mecca dealt mostly with the philosophical and theological issues, that is, study about the religion, its origin and development. On the other hand, the messages received by the Prophet in Medina were mostly socio-economic in nature and dealt with the regulation of society and people thereof. All these preachings were compiled in the Holy Quran after the demise of the Prophet, peace be upon him. The Quran is the final authority on any issue related to Muslim personal law in strict sense. The Quran can't be called a legal code, and a Muslim jurist agree that it contains the verses explaining the way of living and the morals of life, and it is not a legal code backed by sanctions. Number two, as a primary source comes the Sunnah, and this Sunnah, the Arabic habitual practice, also spelled Sunnah, the body of traditional social and legal customs and practice of Islamic community. Sunnah is another primary source of Muslim law, but comes after the Quran. After the demise of the Prophet Muhammad, the Muslims were divided into two sects on the issues of the worthy and competent successor, first being the Shia Muslims and the second being the Sunni Muslims. One sect believed that the one elected by the people as the Khalifa would be the successor of the Prophet, that is, in a democratic way, while the other sect believed that only the descendants or the relatives of the Prophet could be worthy successors, that is, through the heredity. And the division of the religion also led to several books and scriptures becomes a source of Muslim law. One such source is the Sunnah. And Sunnah is followed by the Shia Muslims in their day-to-day lives to comprehend answers to questions that they face. Sunnah is believed to be the customs and traditions followed by the Prophet himself and his words, actions and assertions. According to the Quran, the Prophet preached that his tradition and his actions should be followed even after his death and thereof. Therefore, the action of his daughter and Shia and the Shia Imams after the Prophet are also counted in the Sunnah. The word Sunnah basically means path. It connotes that the path that the Prophet followed would be followed by his people after him, peace be upon him. Sunnah is the second in the priority after the Quran. Therefore, whatever there is a situation where the Holy Quran is silent and the people are unable to make decisions, Sunnah is the action for the Prophet as followed. It means Sunnah teaches the people what Prophet would be done himself if he has any such a situations like this. Since people believe that his actions are motivated by the God's grace and his actions are those of God himself, adhere to Sunnah became popular. The third one is said to be the Hadith or Hadith, but it is written like H-A-D-I-T-H-S. The Hadith are the books containing the Sunnah. It means Sunnah is the action and the words spoken by the Prophet, and Hadith is the scripture where there are a recorded. That means Sunnah is an action and a Hadith is the written form of that action. What Prophet used to do and what Prophet used to say is said to be a Sunnah. Yes, come to the point. It is believed that the Prophet forbade his followers from writing his preachings and his actions. He believed that the writing that was being done might cause confusion between his actions and the words of the Quran. Therefore, no hadith has been discovered from the time of the Prophet. Nevertheless, it is believed that after his death, Sunnah were written down in several books and all compiled together are called the Hadith. But as usual, the Hadith is generally not in contrary to the Holy Quran. What the Holy Quran says, and that will be the first one, and the Hadith will be the secondary, it will be considered, where Quran is silent. Yes, the question therefore that emerges, that if Hadiths were written after the death of the Prophet Muhammad, what is the authenticity of such a document? This question was also considered by the early Islam scholars who wrote the Hadith. To ensure the authenticity of the books, the Muslim scholars wrote the hadith with the reference of their sources and the reference of the references to that, all the references linked in some way to the Prophet or an Imam. All measures were taken to maintain the veracity of the wordings in the hadith. Generally speaking, hadith are not different from Sunnah, and therefore there is no hierarchy between them. Sunnah is what being followed, while hadith is book containing the Sunnah, like the text contained in the textbook. Excuse me. And the fourth ijma, that is the fourth source is ijma. After Prophet Muhammad's demise, there was a consensus in the Muslim world that opinion of religious jurists will prevail. In other words, the mujahids, jurists with the knowledge of Islam, will interpret the Quran, Sunnah and Hadith. The common opinion of the jurist as aspect that the Quran did not explain the became the ijma. This source of law is very expansive and covers many topics. In fact, it gets almost much importance in the Quran and Sunnah themselves. And the last one is Qiyas. As Islam spreads in different parts of the world, they rendezvous with the several other communities such as the Byzantines and Persians, and with the passage of time, new difficulties arose. The Holy Quran was not capable of dealing with the new emerging difficulty arising from the contact with the outside the world. To resolve this problem, the Muslim jurists commenced referring to Quran and Sunnah to compare the situation and deduce an answer to the problem on the basis of some analogy. And when the answer is found, then all the jurists together agree to it. It was called Qiyas. Thus, Qiyas are ijmas based on deductive logic when other above three sources are silent at the time. Ijma and Qiyas will be followed, and is based on deductive logic. And that is all regarding the primary sources are concerned. Now let us come to the secondary sources of Muslim law. Now, as aforementioned, the legislatures and judiciary ought to be the primary source of any law. Nevertheless, since Muslim personal law is a law based on the religious ethics and principles, the legislature takes back stand. The following are the secondary sources that have led to the development of the Muslim personal law. Generally, legislation comes first, but as per the personal law is concerned, and becomes a secondary source. So, let us see what is the legislation says. And regarding the legislation says, legislation means situate the statutes enacted by the parliament or the state legislature for the regulation of the human actions in a particular aspect. There have been several legislations enacted by the parliament to lay the foundation of the Muslim law in India. The first law that was passed was the Shariat Act 1937. In Islam, the entire body of law that governs their day-to-day personal laws, marriage, divorce are collectively called the Sharia. Thus, based on Sharia and with the object to make it a complete body of the Muslim law, the act was titled as the Sharia Act. It contained only 6 provisions dealing mainly with. Number 1, the law related with the succession of a Muslim person dying intestate, that is, without a will or a testament. Then 2nd, the law relating the vesting of the properties of the gifts on female of the sect. The 3rd one, law relating to marriage, divorce, grounds for divorce, mehar, guardianship and maintenance. And the 4th, yes. The law relating the works, that is any trust created for the Muslim religions. And these are the certain things which is embedded in the Shariat Act. And the issue of drivers has been a major drawback of Muslim personal law, because the Holy Quran gives the right to divorce a woman to her husband, but it is silent on the delivery of divorce by a woman. This has led to a struggle by a woman in an unhappy marriage and affected by domestic violence and qiyas. In 1939, an attempt was made to allow the woman to divorce their husband through the Dissolution of Marriage Act 1939. It is one of the legislation by the Muslims. The woman would divorce their husband on the 3 main grounds, that is namely, refusal from maintaining the wife financially and emotionally, and ill treatment in the matrimonial house, and the desertion by the husband. That is a desertion by the husband. Another issue that came after the divorce was the maintenance of the divorced wife. Since women in India are still fighting for the rights to work and equal opportunity in employment, women needed a certain financial security for their livelihood and their children's. well-being. Hence, the Muslim Women's within bracket Protection of Rights and Divorce Act 1986 was enacted that gave them the right to maintenance from their husband. The most recent development in the legislation has been Triple Talaq Bill, that is the Muslims Women Protection Right and Marriage Bill, that is 2019, and prohibit any form of any oral or written declaration of divorce to be illegal unless it is executed with the due procedure of law. Then comes the secondary one, is the secondary source of judicial pronouncements. It is said that the law protects only the vigilant, and that is this is very much right in the case of the Muslims in India. The development of Muslim law by the judiciary came into this full development in the 1980s, because till then the Muslim men and women have been sleeping on their rights and were ignorant about their rights. The first landmark judgment and deals with the Muslim personal law was the 1986 judgment in Shahbano Begum versus Muhammad Ahmad Khan. In this case, the apex court held that Muslim women have a right to maintenance under section 125 of the CRPC, even if the Quran or their personal laws have provided for an alternate remedy. The same ratio was upheld by the apex court in Daniel Latif versus Union of India. Recently, in the leading case of Shayara Banu versus Union of India, the apex court held the system of instantaneous divorce by the utterance of the word talaq thrice orally unconstitutional, because the right to instantaneous divorce is only with the men and not men and not women. Further, the system is arbitrary and hence violation of the Article 14 of the Constitution. Therefore, the judiciary has assisted in the development of the Muslim personal law. And this is the end of the today's lecture regarding the topic sources of Muslim.